Good morning, New Beginnings family. My name is Pastor Neil Platon, and I welcome you to New Beginnings Worship. We're glad that you're here with us today as we worship God together. As we gather our hearts this morning, hear now these words. Give thanks to God, all ye people. Proclaim God's goodness throughout all the world. Let all of us gathered here celebrate God's absolute love. Let us offer our lives in service to others. Thanks be to God for the blessings which have been poured on us. To this end, let us worship God.
Good morning. Please join me in the call to worship. This is the fifth step on our Lenten journey, the step of sacrifice. Be with us, Lord, as we take this step. This requires the willingness to give all of your life to the Lord. Be with us, Lord, as we commit our lives to you. Come, let us worship and offer our voices of praise to God. Let us open our hearts and spirits to God this day. Amen.
Ye servants of God, your master proclaim, and publish abroad his wonderful name. The name of victorious of Jesus extol, his kingdom is glorious and rules over.
Join me in the opening prayer. Lord, be with us this day as we commit ourselves to being your disciples. Help us to face the future unafraid, trusting in your loving care and presence with us. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen.
I wanted to talk to you a little bit about if you know the difference between fake or real. Sometimes people go to church and they pray to Jesus and they praise Jesus, but when it's their turn to go out to the public, they don't really help people. And in the Bible, there's a story where there's these people who pretend to care about the widow and pretend to help them and go back to the church, and they request to have the best seat and all that stuff, but when it's their turn to go out, they don't help anybody. But the widow, She has a really good heart and she gives everything that she has. She doesn't have a lot of stuff, but with whatever little bit that she does have, she goes out and she helps people and she gives to people. And we should be like that. We should have that kind of heart that the widow has and help people. Give whatever it is that you have. Talk to people, teach people, make people feel good about themselves.
We're doing something different, New Beginnings family. Usually we would have our readings for birthdays and anniversaries at the end of the month. And that gives us a short time to greet our celebrants. And so beginning this month, we will be having it during the second Sunday of every month. And so let us now gather our hearts as we extend our greetings to our March celebrants for both birthdays and anniversaries. For birthdays, we have James Grindle, Emma Leonard, Julia Plunk, Diana Lindsay, Linda Berry, Dennis Maniaco, Leola Ray, Marsha Van Camp, Chris Oxnivad, William Moore, Helen McVeigh, Noah Sorensen, Michaela Rourke, Ashley Oswald, Antoinette Leifer, and Mary Corral. For anniversaries, we have Don and Joyce Leifer, Chuck and Nancy Denton, Susan Cargill and George Fairbairn, Tommy and Wilma Alabama. So to all of our celebrants, blessings from your New Beginnings family. Let us now prepare our hearts for prayer as we sing, "Open Our Eyes, Lord." The days are getting longer, Lord. The sun's rays are higher in the sky, bringing more light to our world. Warmth begins to flood over the colder portions of our nation. Let the warmth of your mercy and love pour over us. As we have gathered this day to celebrate the good news that you have given to the world, remind us that it is our purpose to offer that good news to others, not only in words, but in deeds of love and mercy, peace and justice. As we have offered names of people and situations which have been heavy on our hearts and minds for your healing mercies, remind us also that we stand in need of that self-same healing love. As we have prayed for ministries of peace and justice and for those engaged in those wondrous missions, remind us that we are also on a journey of peace and justice whenever we offer comfort and aid to others. O Lord, be with us during this Lenten season. Give us hearts of great joy and courage to serve you all of our days. For we ask all of this in the name of our Lord and of our Savior, Jesus Christ, and who taught us to pray by saying together, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
The scripture reading is from Luke 20, verses 45 through chapter 21, verse 4. In the hearing of all the people, he said to the disciples, Beware of the scribes, who like to walk around in long robes, and love to be greeted with respect in the marketplaces, and to have the best seats in the synagogues, and places of honor at banquets. They devour widows' houses, and for the sake of appearance, say long prayers. They will receive the greater condemnation. He looked up and saw rich people putting their gifts into the treasury. He also saw a poor widow put in two small copper coins. He said, Truly I tell you, this poor widow has put in more than all of them, for all of them have contributed out of their abundance, but she, out of her poverty, has put in all she had to live on.
Can separate, even if I ran away, your love never fails. I know I still make mistakes, but you have new mercies for me every day, your love never fails. Say the same through the ages. Your love never changes. There may be pain in the night, but joy comes in the morning. And when the oceans rage, I don't have to be afraid, because I know that you love me. Your love never fails. miles deeper. I'm not alone here in these open seas. Your love never fails. The chasm was far too wide. I never thought I'd reach the other side. Your love never fails. You say the same through the ages. Your love never changes. There may be pain in the night, but joy comes in the morning. And when the oceans rage, I don't have to be afraid, because I know that you love me. Your love never fails. You make all things work together for my good. And you make all things work together for my good. And you make all things work together for my good. And you make all things work together for my good. And you make all things work together for my good. And you make all things work together for my good. There may be pain in the night, but joy comes in the morning. And when the oceans rage, I don't have to be afraid, because I know that you love me. Your love never fails.
Will you bow your hearts with me as we come to God in prayer? May the words of my mouth and the meditations of all our hearts be made acceptable in thy sight, through Jesus Christ our Lord, our Savior, Redeemer, and Friend. Amen. The Gospels of Luke and Mark report an incident that happened while Jesus was people watching outside the temple, where donations were given to support the temple and the religious establishment. A widow came up to the offering plate, a poor widow, marginalized in society as she was a woman of low status, married once and lost, and unlikely to wed again. With a mortality rate, how it was, she could have been in her mid-20s or early 30s, I guess she is way past her prime. The widow came up and put in her last two pennies. She gave her all. She would have nothing to lie back on. She would be completely at the mercy of a world whose cultural norms turned against her. And she gave away a penny anyway. And Jesus commends her. And we are left asking, why? Why was Jesus commending this woman? Was Jesus commending her because the true measure of gifts is not how much is given, but how much remains behind? She gave everything, so she is better. Was Jesus commending her because what matters is the spirit in which the gift is given? She gave out of a different sensibility than the rich Pharisees. Was Jesus more concerned with the amount or the percentage? But then we wonder an even darker thought, why is a religious reformer such as Jesus, who says cruel things about the religious establishment, commenting on how to give the best gift to the religious establishment, the same establishment that would crucify him a few chapters later? Jesus commends the woman. I mean, it doesn't make sense. Best arguments fall short. Biblical scholars generally say that Jesus says to support the church rather than human needs. That when the choice is between our comfort and the church, we are to give to the church. That makes for a good stewardship line in contemporary sermons on sacrificial giving and priorities. But that's not what Jesus says elsewhere in any of the Gospels. So how could a widow whose money is used to support her, the marginalized society, how could she possibly be commended for her gift to the very institution that harmed her? Jesus commends her, and it doesn't make sense, using Jesus' own words in chapter 20. But wait, there's more in this chapter in Luke. In Luke's version, Jesus throws down against the religious elites in this way. The scribes who like to go about in long robes and the best seats in the synagogue and the place of honor at feasts, who devour widows' houses and for a pretense make long prayers, they will receive the greater condemnation. I mean, he calls out the wealthy and powerful of his day, saying that they rob the widows' houses. Oh, not rob, they devour the widows' houses, consume, eat the livelihood of the marginalized of society. And like a Hollywood moment that fulfills the foreshadowing, in the next chapter is a widow whose house has been devoured. And she is giving up to give her last to the people that Jesus said devoured her. Dr. Thomas Long at Candler School of Theology said in a sermon one time, quote, "This woman gave everything, all right. They took every last penny from her." And Jesus commends her, or does he? Read again what Jesus said. He looked up and saw rich people putting their gifts into the treasury. He also saw a poor widow put in two small copper coins. He said, "Truly I tell you, this poor widow has put on more than all of them. For all of them have contributed out of their abundance, but she gave out of her poverty, has put in all she had to live on." Jesus does not commend the woman. I mean, no congratulations or blessed are or the kingdom of God is like kind of language here. Rather, Jesus describes the scene. Jesus doesn't commend. Rather, our Lord laments. He laments that the woman, the victim of the religious value system, gave up more than the perpetrators of that system. He laments that she lost more than the ones who benefited from it. I mean, it's a tale as old as time. People forced out of their homes in loss more than the bankers who lost jobs, and none of them went to debtor's prison. The swamp wasn't drained, and the states who voted 70% or more for the current administration will be the first to lose health care. Jesus laments the victim of oppression. He doesn't commend her. Indeed, Jesus even sees her gift as a waste. As the following verses of Luke 21 indicate, the very temple that the widow was contributing to would fall. And we know historically that it did. She gave an offering that was a waste. And Jesus, our Lord, laments along with the widow. Why would Jesus tell such a sad and misunderstood story? Because Jesus began the revolution that said, never again. Never again will the marginalized be left out of the blessings of God and the church call it good. Never again will we turn a blind eye while our leaders harm those in poverty and the church call it good. Never again will people who don't fit the mold be left on the threshing floor and the church call it good. Never again. Well, unless we let it. Jesus calls us to remember the widow and put our all in the basket, to be all in, to be the voice of protest and solidarity that stands with the least of these and the lost, to be all in through substantive gifts of charity and substantive efforts towards justice, to be all in to education of our young people and iron sharpening iron experiences for our adults, to be all in using our connections and gifts to make justice happen in our world, not just lament on how things are. Are you all in? Or do the powers and principalities that devour widows and others have the last word? And you remember her only to think about how much you'll give or tithe this year. In closing, I mean, I've sold probably the widow short, and I need to apologize for that. Yes, she was devoured by the people and the system. Yes, she lost everything to a culture that despises broken families and lacked grace. But in my mind, she walked up to that offering plate with her head held high, high and defiant. She wanted to make the Pharisees and the tax collectors and the world to see her mighty face saying, look what you made me to do. Nobel Prize winner Lema Bowie has spoken before about the day she won the Nobel Peace Prize, saying, quote, there is a saying, he who is down fears no fall. Well, if I'm already down, I can speak truth. I like to believe that the widow spoke her truth in that moment as the pennies clink into the offering plate. Do you hear it? Amen. New Beginnings family, we hope that you have been getting our church updates. If you haven't, please let us know. Call us at 909-515-5770 or email us at newbeginnings.mbie@gmail.com. To keep everybody safe, we're still limiting access to all of our campuses. If you need to get on any of our campuses, you can call Gail. Her email is at gapt.nbie@gmail.com. We continue to have our weekly Zoom studies. Don Liefer leads us on Tuesday evenings with What's in Your Hymnal. This study starts at 7 p.m. In addition, we also have free opportunities for Lenten study. Pastor Alex leads our Monday study at 9:30 in the morning and yours truly on Tuesday mornings at 11 and Friday evenings at 7 p.m. Check out our website, nbie.org, for more information. We also have weekly Lenten video devotionals that come out on Thursday mornings on our YouTube channel. and Facebook pages. So do check out these opportunities as we continue with the Lenten season. We now have our March and April copies of the Upper Rooms. So if you'd like to receive a copy of this devotional, please let us know. Call us in our church office, and I'll be more than happy to deliver this to you. Right after our worship, we will be having our Zoom coffee hour as we connect and check in with each other. Check out the chat, our website, or email blast for the link to our Zoom fellowship hour. Today, we're also having a special offering to benefit UMCOR. UMCOR is the United Methodist Committee on Relief. This is an agency of the United Methodist Church that responds to calamities all over the world. So if you'd like to contribute to this, go on to our website. Truly, we have been blessed and thankful for all of your continuing support to New Beginnings. If you would like to give financially to the church, you can do so by writing a check payable to New Beginnings United Methodist Church and mail it to our downtown campus. You can also go on our website, nbie.org, and go on the giving tab. You can also give through text. Here is now a short video on how to text to give. Again, we thank you all for your generous support and prayers for New Beginnings. And may God continue to bless us all.
God forgave my sin in Jesus' name. I've been born again in Jesus' name. And in Jesus' name I come to you to share His love as He told me to. He said, freely, freely you have received, freely, freely give. Go in my name, and because you believe, others will know. Born again in Jesus' name,
We are created in Christ Jesus for good works, and this is his gift to us. Let us now do the loving, good work of giving our lives back to him. God's great love and rich mercy have made us alive in Christ. Friends, let us depart to live lives of grace and to do good works to others. Go in peace, my dear friends, and until we meet again, in Christ's name we pray. Amen.